Hello everyone, my name is Sachin Kapoor. I am the CEO at Sharma Computer Academy Bhopal, and I welcome you all on this series of learning Java online. I hope you would be benefited from all these lecture series. So let's get started with our very first lecture. The agenda for today's lecture is, we are mainly going to focus on two things. The very first thing is, what is Java? Some very common myths regarding Java would be removed in this lecture. The second point which I am going to cover is the primary reasons behind popularity of Java. Like why Java is so popular, why in the first 10 or first 5 languages, top languages of the world, still there is a place for Java. So today's lecture will be covering these two things, that is, what is Java and reasons behind popularity of Java. So let's begin with the very first part, what is Java? Officially, the basic definition for Java is a technology. Please pay close attention to this word, not a language. I'll be focusing on the difference between a technology and a language, but to begin with, Java is a technology to develop object-oriented and, the most important and key feature, platform-independent applications. So the three keywords in this definition are the word technology, the word object-oriented, which I think most of you must be familiar with, and the most important thing is platform-independent application. So first of all, I would cover the meaning of the word platform-independent. But before we can understand what is platform-independent, let's begin our discussion with a very common word in computing arena, that is platform. Like, you should be very clear with the concept of the word platform, then only you can understand the meaning of the word platform independent, and then only you can truly justify why Java is so popular as a technology or as a language, like everyone says. So the meaning of the word platform in computer programming is, it's the environment in which an application or a program executes. I repeat, platform is the environment in which an application or a program executes. Put simply, or in simple terms, I can say that it is the combination of operating system as well as the CPU which help the execution of a program or which control the execution of a program. So a platform is nothing but a combination of those two things which manage the execution of a program. One of them is the key feature, the key part is played by operating system, and another thing is central processing unit or CPU. You also can say it's just a combination of a software and a hardware which is required for executing, for running any particular application. So if I say I'm having a Windows PC, any form of Windows, let's say I'm having Windows 7 running over Core i5, this is one platform, got it? And if I'm having another computer which is running over Linux machine, it's having a Linux operating system and it's running over, let's say, AMD processor, advanced micro devices, this is another platform. I mean to say, if the operating system or the CPU changes, then we say that platform has changed. So let me explain it this way. Let's say I'm having 10 laptops kept in front of me. Each of these laptops is having Windows 7 and Core i5. Each of these laptops is having Windows 7 and Core i5. Physically, they might appear to be 10 different machines. But logically, from the point of view of a program, they all represent one single platform, one single machine. That is why, because their platform or their operating systems are same. But if one of those machines is having Linux or say one of those machines is having Mac. Then rest 9 of them will represent one platform, but that single machine will represent a different platform. Why this difference is there? Because the operating systems, they have different way of interpreting a particular program or a particular application. Like everyone knows that computers understand the language of zeros and ones. But very few of us know that the way they understand language of zeros and ones differs from one computer or one platform to another. It's similar to that we say English is spoken all over the world, but the accent of English varies from country to country. Similarly, the way an operating system interprets a particular 0 and 1 combination or a binary combination is different from the way another operating system interprets it. In computing paradigm, we say it is instruction set. So, the instruction set of Windows 7 is different than instruction set of Linux, which is again different than instruction set of Mac operating system. So, if I am having three different machines, all of them are having same operating system, same CPU, I would say they represent single platform. If I am having three different machines with three different operating systems, I would say they represent three different platforms, or we can also say they represent three different machines. So make sure you are very clear with this concept before we move further to understand what is the meaning of the word platform independent. This was the meaning of the word platform. Now let's understand platform independency. But before going towards that, let's have a quick look at the way a C or C++ program is compiled and executed. Why we say that C and C++ are platform dependent languages, and why we say that Java is a platform independent language, or to be very specific, technology. So let's begin with the way C language compiles and executes its program. We all know that when we develop a C program, that program is basically called as source code. It's a C, C++ source code. We all know this also, that this source code is never directly passed on to the operating system. There is a special software in between the OS and your source code called as a compiler, which compiles your program and generates the machine code. Although we call it object code, but let's use the word machine code. So what compiler generates is called as the machine code. Normally we just know that this machine code comprises of zeros and ones, but do remember this machine code comprises of a special instruction set which is generated for a particular platform. What do I mean by this, by for a particular platform? Let's say we are having a particular compiler. Let's say we are having a TC compiler. We all know that TC compiler has been developed to run over DOS machines. The operating system DOS, it handles the execution of TC compiler. Now what happens is, when turbo compiler compiles your source code and generates the machine code, it is specifically targeted towards DOS operating system. That is, the way it converts this source code and generates the machine code, this conversion process is targeted towards DOS, so that DOS can easily interpret this machine code. Now what happens is, suppose we import this machine code over another platform. Let's say that another platform is a Linux machine. When this machine code will be imported over Linux, this machine will outright reject the instruction set generated by TC compiler, because as I said earlier, the machine code or instruction set generated for one platform is altogether different as the machine code generated for another platform. Now think, as a software developer, suppose you have developed a very good software, a very good application in C and C++. Let's say you have developed a particular media player. Now when this media player will be compiled by your C compiler, it will generate a specific machine code targeted towards the very same platform for which this compiler has been written. That is one big reason why we have n number of compilers of C language available in market. We have a turbo compiler, we have a GCC, we have code blocks, we have dev C++, n number of compilers are there because there are n number of platforms. And each platform has got its own instruction set, its own way of interpreting the machine code generated by the compiler. So what happens is, the machine code which compiler generates, let's say which TC generates for DOS platform, can never be accepted by any other platform which is different than DOS or which has a different instruction set as compared to DOS. So now think, as a software developer, what happens? You have developed a media player, you have compiled your code using Turbo Compiler, your code is running fine on DOS PCs, but when you import this code or when you sell out this code to a customer who is having, let's say, a Mac operating system or a Linux operating system, your machine code would be rejected by that operating system, because the instruction set for this machine code is only available to be interpreted by DOS. All other operating systems will totally reject that. That is the meaning of the word platform dependent. It means that if I have to sell out this code, this machine code, to Linux user, I'll have to again write this program, I'll have to again compile it using some compiler which can generate machine code for Linux machines. Or let's say I'm having a customer from Mac background, he's having a Mac PC, I'll have to write the source code, compile it using Xcode. Xcode will generate some kind of machine code. That machine code I will supply to that user. It means that if I'm a software developer, I'll have to make 10 different copies of my program, one copy targeting to one particular operating system, and then only I can sell this machine code in the market. That was a big, big problem in the 90s era. And that was the main problem with developers of Java language notified, and they tried to remove that. They thought, why not bring one such language in the market which can develop, which can be used to develop or compile applications in such a way, that the compiled code can be executed on any machine without writing the application again. I repeat the statement, Java language has one important point to remember, that it compiles the code in such a way that the compiled code, which is not called as machine code, it's called something else, I'll explain it later. The compiled code generated by Java language can be easily executed on any platform available in the market today. Any platform, you can import that code and the code would be successfully executed there. Since the code has to be written only once, but it can be executed anywhere on any machine, we say Java is a platform independent language, or it truly justifies the punchline of Java, which is Vora. Vora stands for write once, run anywhere. This is the meaning of Java's punchline, Vora. So, to begin with, that Java is platform independent, it means that a program written on a particular platform, compiled on a particular platform, can have its compiled code imported to any other platform of the world. And on that platform also, the program will be executed without writing the code again, without showing any kind of change in its behavior. If a language has this kind of feature, we say that language is platform independent language. Now let's try to understand how Java was able to achieve this feature. What Java does to achieve platform independency? What is that magical thing in Java which makes a Java code compiled on one machine or platform to be executed on any other platform? So listen carefully and try to understand each and every detail of Java's way of compiling and executing our program. Listen carefully. Let's say we have developed a Java source code and we are having a Windows machine, say Windows 7 machine. Now, we all know that a source code is always compiled by some kind of translators. No doubt, Java also has a translator, that is compiler. The Java compiler, like any other language, compiles our source code, but point of difference comes here. The Java compiler never ever generates machine code. Never ever generates machine code. What the Java compiler does, it generates another code which is basically called as bytecode. So from now onwards, we can say there are three kinds of codes. Source code, which can be directly understood by humans. Machine code, which can be understood by operating systems. And there is a code which is not meant for humans nor for operating system. It could be called as an intermediate code, but what Java has used the word is bytecode. So what Java compiler generates is not machine code, it is the bytecode. Now as I said, bytecode is neither understood by humans nor operating systems can understand this. So there has to be someone who can convert this bytecode as per this underlying operating system's instruction set. That someone is actually a special layer which gets installed on our machine, on our platform as we install the Java software, and that special layer is actually a software called JVM. It's actually a part of another big software called JRE, but to be very specific, let's talk about JVM. JVM, its full form stands for Java Virtual Machine. I'll explain the meaning of this full form, but let's first complete this part. So what happens is, the Java compiler converts your source code into the corresponding bytecode. This bytecode, as I said, cannot be directly passed on to Windows operating system because it knows nothing about handling this bytecode. It's an entirely new way, entirely new language. So there is a layer, a special layer of software developed by the company which has developed Java language. This particular software or JVM reads this bytecode and converts its instructions as per the underlying platform. That is, whatever source code's conversion to bytecode has been done, it's further converted as per Windows platform, as per Windows operating system. Now, it means that JVM plays the key role in converting bytecode according to the underlying platform. Now, suppose I'm having, now we are trying to understand how this makes Java platform independent. Now suppose we are having a Linux machine and we also are having a Mac machine. I have compiled the Java code on Windows platform. The compiler has generated the bytecode for me. I want to run this bytecode on Linux. But all I need is just a special layer which I told you earlier, that is JVM. So if one of my customers is having a Linux machine, other customer is having a Mac machine, I would only ask them to install this particular software which is available for free download on site, on Sun site. You can download it from there. You can download it, install it, and your machine is ready to execute this particular bytecode. That means any platform of the world which has a JVM installed onto it can be used to execute the bytecode, the compiled code, irrespective of where this bytecode has been compiled. So let's say this is a MP3 player developed in Java language. The Java compiler will convert this player into a bytecode. This bytecode will be imported on any platform, any device, and every device which wants to run this bytecode just requires one software which is available free of cost, and that software is nothing but JVM, which can be freely downloaded from the site of Sun Microsystems or Oracle Sun. Which means that on every platform, every computer, just we require one special software to run a Java application, and that software is basically called as JVM, which, as I said, comes as a part of JRE. Now, this makes Java a platform independent language. Let's take it with another example. Now, let's suppose I develop a calculator in Java and I'm developing the calculator on Linux machine. I'm using Linux. The Java compiler will now convert this to a corresponding bytecode. But compiler has no idea that it is writing this bytecode for Linux. What it all knows is just the bytecode language. Now this bytecode can be easily migrated to Windows, where the JVM present for Windows will convert this bytecode instructions as per Windows platform, or the JVM present for Linux will convert it as per Linux platform, or the JVM available for Mac will convert it as per the Mac platform. So try to understand, I have to write the code only once, but after writing it once, I am able to run it on every platform where a JVM is available. And this truly justifies this punchline, why Java is write once and run anywhere. This is the most important thing to understand, that why do we say that Java is a platform independent technology. Now let's make very clear regarding the word technology, why is it wrong to say that Java is just a language? A language is something which simply compiles your code and leaves it. The rest of the part or execution part is exclusively handled by the operating system. I repeat, a language just has a translator which compiles your code and converts it into machine-dependent form. But the case of Java is a bit different. In Java, when we compile our code, the compiled code cannot be executed by the operating system alone. Its execution is exclusively handled by a Java software, which is called as JVM. Which means that when we run a C program, C plays no role in it. It's entirely handled by operating system. But when we run a Java program, its execution is not handled by directly by operating system. It's always handled in conjunction, in continuation with JVM. That means without the presence of JVM, you can never run a Java application on any other platform or any other computer. That means running a Java program requires the support of Java, as well as compiling a Java program also requires the support of Java. Since Java plays a major role in execution of our code, we can't say it's just a language, we say it's a technology. To be more specific, all the things which are done by an operating system for a C language application, those things are done by JVM for a Java application. For example, we all know the execution of a C program begins from main, and main is a function which is called by OS. In Java also we have the same concept, the execution begins from main. But main in Java is not called by the OS, it's actually called by the JVM. We all know memory allocation for our variables, arrays, functions, everything is handled by OS. In Java, all this allocation is handled by JVM. In C++, we all know that when the execution of the program is over, the memory is recollected by operating system using a process called garbage collection. In Java, this garbage collection kind of thing is also managed by JVM. So each and everything which is done by operating system for a C++ program is actually done by JVM for a Java program. So it would be false to say, or we can say we are making Java less powerful by simply saying that it's a language. It's not a language. It's actually a technology which has got a compiler which makes it a language, as well as a software which makes it execute our program, which is called as JVM. And hence we say it's just a technology, not simply a language, using which we can develop object-oriented as well as platform-independent application. Platform means the environment in which a code is running. Platform independent means if this environment changes, the code's behavior should not change, or we should not write the code again if the platform has changed. Same code can run on n number of platforms without any change in its behavior, without any change in its output. In that case, we say the language or the technology is platform independent. And Java is a platform independent technology which is used to develop these kinds of object-oriented applications. I hope this would have made most of the things clear regarding the popularity of Java, why Java is so much popular, because we have so many platforms in this world. A developer writing an application need not worry that on which platform the application will run. What all is required is just a JVM should be present on that platform, and your code would be fully executed on that platform without you writing the code again. I hope everything must be clear. Hope to see you in the next lecture. In next lecture, we'll discuss all other remaining features which have made Java so popular. But this was the most important feature, that Java is a platform independent technology. Thank you for the hearing. Hope to see you in the next lecture.